everyone, and welcome to another episode in our interview series, Ask the Expert, organized by the Girl Powered Nutrition Advocacy Champions of the Sri Lanka Girl Guides Association. So we hope to make important conversations on nutrition and health available to everyone, accessible to everyone. And that is why we have the GPN interview series here for you today. And so today, to enlighten us about the increased prevalence of obesity among teenagers in Sri Lanka, we have with us our very own GPN advocacy champion and SLMC registered dietitian and nutritionist and AFN UK registered nutritionist, Ms. Lasika Jayamaha. Lasika is currently also the resident dietitian and nutritionist at the Durden's Hospital and is also our very own nutrition expert here at the SLGGA. Having obtained the President's Guide Award, Lasika is no stranger to the SLGGA and the GPN. So it is our pleasure to have her here with us today. So without further ado, let us jump right into the interview. So one of the most imminent problems that we face in the 21st century is the spread of non-communicable diseases, and a factor that considerably impacts this spread of non-communicable diseases is obesity. So which is why it's extremely important for all of us to learn about the causes and the consequences of obesity and how it can affect all of us and our family. So in accordance with the GPN yellow stage, which focuses on why good nutrition is important for us now and in the future, today we will be talking with Lasika about the prevalence of obesity in teenagers, and in particular, how it affects the girl child. So Lasika, will you be able to tell us a definition for obesity, the signs and the symptoms?
Thank you, Ashwini. Obesity we usually define as an abnormal or excessive fat accumulation in the body that impairs our health. So if you look at the BMI, is probably something that you have heard of. We call it the body mass index, and it is used to classify obesity. For children between 5 to 19 years, we look at the BMI for age, and if it is greater than 2 standard deviations according to the WHO growth chart, then from their median, we classify them as being obese. So that is the very basic definition of how, for the teenagers or the adolescent age group that we're looking for, how we will be defining obesity.
Right, okay. So what are the causes for obesity, and could you like elaborate on the risk factors, if any?
Yes, there are many causes. And if we look at the main or the most common cause, is we look at how our environment will impact this. So this is when we have body fat, which is because of the excess storage of energy. And this energy is because we have consumed a lot more food than we require. And it is not used up. So we don't have enough physical activities. So there's excess energy that is stored in the form of fat. So this is the main cause of obesity. Or in simple, if we say that we have eaten far too much and we haven't really consumed, we haven't really expended that energy. Of course, there could be also the genetic component, where maybe we are more prone to be on the obese or overweight side. And it could be also certain medications that we are on that is the reason for us to gain weight. But the main cause is that we would be having excess food that is from the excess, or the, a lot of the food that we have, which is high in sugar and starch and oils and fats that we consume, together with low levels of physical activity, which is very common, not only in adolescents, but children as well as adults.
Right. Thank you so much for that explanation. And just to clarify, I heard that you can be anemic and still be obese. So what is your opinion on that? And is that actually really true?
Yes, that's a very interesting question, Ashwini. And that is true, because if you look at being obese, it is about having excess energy. So that is coming from your macronutrients, which is your starches or the carbohydrates, or your fats and oils from those components. But being iron deficient is because you are lacking a certain micronutrient. So just because you are having a lot of macronutrients and you have a huge body weight doesn't mean you are also having your micronutrients. So you could possibly be a micronutrient deficient, and especially in iron. So those two can exist at the same time.
Right. I think that's really important to consider, and it's something important that all of us need to know, especially in relation with nutrition of like girl children. Thank you, Lasika, for that. And we wanted to know, is obesity more common in adolescent males or females? And what is your opinion on that?
So it is fairly similar, but if you look at the statistics, for our adolescent age group, I looked at the recent statistics that we have for, in particular, looking at the scaling up nutrition statistics. So we had 12.7% of overweight adolescent males, which is higher than 11.2% for the females. So there's no statistic for the obese category, but we look at overweight category, which is also slightly less. So that if that's a good indication of where obesity is heading. So because that's one step just under becoming into the obese category.
Right. In terms of the consequences of obesity, what can you tell us about the morbidity, the mortality, and how it affects the risk of us developing non-communicable diseases? And very especially, can you tell us what this means for the girl child in particular?
So if we look at the consequences of obesity, definitely if we are obese, then we are more likely to have non-communicable diseases, and that is a very broad title. So it could improve or put us at risk of diabetes, heart disease, which is becoming more common in younger age groups. So those days it was something that was common among adults. But now we see a lot of teenagers also with these conditions. And then you can also be at risk for certain types of cancers. You could have joint pain related problems like arthritis, osteoarthritis. Those are also because your weight is too much and your joints can't take it. And then this becomes actually, it's a very big burden, not only on yourself. So if you are obese and then you go on to develop these diseases, you as a person can't do any work. So you can't study properly, which means you won't be able to study further or get a proper job. And that's going to impact your family as well, because you might have to pay for hospital bills and that sort of thing as well. So your also your power to, you know, leave school and be able to find a job and support your family goes down. You might not be able to attend school as well if you get these conditions much younger when you're still at that stage of studying. And if you are like that and then you go on to have your family as well, a family of your own, especially for the girl child, then you're going to have kids that will also be born with these conditions as well, or they will more likely get these conditions at a very young age. Because most of these non-communicable diseases, you see them coming on in the next generation as well. So it can be passed on to the next generation. And sometimes it comes along a lot earlier in the next generation. So there is an effect which goes on and on and on. So you have to stop it at some point, or at least try to prevent it, because otherwise we're going to have a generation that is going to be very sick.
Right. So is that to say obesity can also have genetic causes?
Obesity, yes, it can have genetic causes as well. But obesity can also put you at risk factors for other diseases as well. So it goes both ways as well.
Right. Yes. Okay. Right. So we've discussed the problems and the causes, the symptoms of obesity. So what can you tell us about how we can alleviate this problem? How can we prevent obesity?
Okay, so everybody knows how important it is to focus on the diet. So that is just one part of it. And like I said also, like if you have a genetic condition of being obese, then it might be a little bit difficult. But still, if you look at the diet of one, I think the diet and the lifestyle that we have at present doesn't help. So it puts us more at risk of being obese. So what we can do is to try and follow a healthy, balanced diet in simple. But if you talk a little bit more about that, it's trying to include more fruits and vegetables, making sure we get the healthy versions of protein. So it can be the pulses or the legumes that we include, the fish, the eggs, the lean meat, nuts, seeds, so healthy oils as well. At the same time, we need to try and cut off all the excess, you know, the calorie dense foods that we have. So like a lot of sweet or sugary items, a lot of fried things, and, you know, just also the quantity that you eat. So it's not to say that you need to be very strict, but you can still enjoy, you know, the nice foods that could be fried or sweet in taste. But that shouldn't be your entire, you know, that shouldn't form the main part of your meal. So you need to have all the healthy foods as well. So you get all your macronutrients, like the healthy starches, the proteins, the oils, as well as your micronutrients as well, like your iron, zinc, folate, like the B vitamins and all of that as well. So it needs, there needs to be a combined effect, which is what we call a healthy and balanced diet. So diet is just one thing, like I said, and the other thing is the role of physical activity. So like I said earlier, that physical activity is something that we lack. And for the children and adolescents, the current recommendation is that we should, that you should engage in at least about 60 minutes of physical activity daily. So this is also not happening at the moment, because I think school and everything else overtakes that. And I think also in this COVID situation, it's probably even worse. So we are seeing an unhealthy diet as well as low physical activity. And this is a very good, you know, ground for increasing the levels of obesity.
Right. So as teenagers and as young children, how can we make healthier food choices when we go grocery shopping?
Yeah, so that's where it starts, I guess. And everybody likes to go shopping, but I'm not sure if everybody likes to go grocery shopping. So maybe that's something that you could make it as a habit. And again, it's always nice to start with, you know, the fresh fruits, vegetables. So from, you know, the fresh ingredients that you can buy, always start from that section. If you go to the supermarket or the grocery shop that you're going to buy your food items from. And if you're buying things that are labeled, it's always good to read the labels. So mm-hmm. Here in Sri Lanka, we have the it's been there for a while, the traffic light labeling system. So it gives you a good indicator of how much sugar, fat, and salt is there in a lot of pre-packed foods and beverages as well. So this is something I think a lot of people are unaware, whether it's adults, whether it's teenagers, across the board. So again, if you are pay a little bit more attention to what ingredients are there and also these labelings. So labels is a good way to understand what you are eating as well. So when you go shopping, it's something that you need to make a habit to try, you know, to see what you're going to have. And it's also a very good idea to make a list of what you want to buy. Because I think if you just walk into a supermarket and say, oh, I'm going to buy a couple of things, you're just going to end up with what you didn't want or didn't think. And you forget what you actually went to buy and you come without that. And another good tip is to always go to a supermarket when you've had something to eat, so on a full stomach, basically. Right. Because if you are very hungry and you go grocery shopping, then you want to eat all or buy all, you know, the things that aren't very healthy, or you tend to over shop as well. So buy what you need as well, because that also helps, you know, to save food wastage as well. So There is a lot of things that you need to, so you basically need to plan your shopping and then go and get what you need.
Right. I think that's a really good psychology hack that I personally will definitely put into practice now. But I was wondering if you could tell us more about the traffic light labeling system for the viewers and what we should aim like at the sugar intake, what are we looking for, and just, you know, generally, what are we looking for when we look at that traffic light labeling system?
Okay. So it's pretty much the same as the normal traffic lights, right? So if it is red, it means it's got a very high content of sugar or fat or salt. And if it's amber, it's got a moderate amount. And if it is green, then it's got, you know, very little. And these are all done for 100 gram volume or 100 ml of whatever the food or the beverage that you're looking at. So ideally, if we, when we go shopping and we look at these things, if we look at, say, for example, biscuits, you know, or some snacks, and then if you go for something that is more with yellow or green, then that's a good choice. And try buying food items or beverages that have a red sticker on it. So, of course, the exceptions is if you go and look at maybe a pack of butter or margarine, then obviously the fat will be red. And again, that's an exception. So that's okay. So it doesn't mean you shouldn't buy it. You can have it, but you're not going to have the whole tub. So that's okay. So that's an exception. But if it's something like a biscuit or, you know, a fruit drink or a milk packet or something like that, which has a labeling system, then it also is a good indicator whether it's got added sugar or how much oil there is in it or how much salt certain biscuits might have. So that's where you can easily use this traffic light labeling system for your snacks and beverages that you want to have in moderation and enjoy them, you know, on a rare occasion rather than on a frequent basis.
Right. So now we've talked about, you know, physical activity and also the food we intake, but could you also like tell if there are any other factors that help prevent obesity and affect obesity? Especially with relevance to the girl child in terms of lifestyle changes, things like that.
Okay, so I think we spoke about physical activity earlier along with the diet. So like I said, another lifestyle change is also to try and include some sort of physical activity. So it could be simple things like you could go for a walk, you could maybe spend some time in the garden. And that is also, there's two things that can come out of that. So you're exercising and you could also possibly be trying to grow some vegetables or fruits or something or herbs in your garden as well. And I would say also to try and think of cooking as a life skill that you can achieve. So I know a lot of guides, we do have the cooking badge. And so most of those things also come into play and it's, you know, it would help. So cooking, a lot of people don't really look at it as a skill, but I think it's good to understand or to learn to know to make something healthy and to be proud that you are able to cook something healthy and to know what ingredients go and what nutritional aspects are there in the food that we eat, rather than always the easiest thing being, oh, can I order something or can I go to the shop and buy something? It'll be nice even if you're having family or friends over or just even for your immediate family. For us as, you know, as adolescent girls to be able to prepare something and to be proud of that. So definitely working on your cooking skills is something that you can try and incorporate. And also another thing is we are bombarded with a lot of advertising and social media plays a huge role in deciding what we want to buy. So I think, again, you need to make informed choices. So like I said, read the labels. That's one thing. Look at where you're getting the information from. Are they trusted sources? So if you're reading an article, who has written the article? Is it a person who is an expert in the field of nutrition or is it a person who's just giving out their opinion? Because opinion is not something that everybody should follow. It's an opinion. You're allowed to have your own opinion. But when somebody starts to follow that opinion, you know, as something that we would call to implement to somebody else's life, then it may not work so well. So we also have a lot of influencers, bloggers. Again, it's nice for certain recipes or to pick up, you know, certain ingredients or whatever. But again, you need to understand that their background may be good for, you know, certain things. But when it comes to nutrition, this is also basically, it's something important. It is a health-related subject. So you need to understand that that is also something you need to be aware of who you're trusting as resource persons in the area of nutrition. So you could, it could be a health professional if you want to really understand on a particular topic on nutrition, or any question that you have, it's better to look for a healthcare professional. It could be a nutritionist, it could be a dietitian, a doctor, a nurse, or it could be even your health teacher in school. So they should be able to give you a much more sound understanding rather than if you read somebody's story or somebody's opinion. So I think that's where a lot of girl childs, for us as a girl child, it's important because we become a little more conscious about what we want to eat as well. So that's another thing that I would like to add, how we can try and prevent obesity.
Right. Thank you so much. So the other question that we have is, it's really easy to look at obesity on a surface level and think of it as a disease that we have to conquer, etc. But could you tell us more about the emotional and psychosocial complications that children or teenagers who have obesity face, and how much it impacts them, and the importance of having a support system?
Yeah, so yeah. That's a very good question. And actually, it's a very... it's an area that is unseen or often ignored, but it is also as important because if you look at being healthy, it's not only about being physically well, but it's also about being mentally well and socially well. So when you stigmatize somebody for being obese or overweight, and you say, well, the automatic thing is that they say, oh, well, you must be eating all the wrong food, or you must be very lazy, that and that's why you are obese. But your environmental factors, like we discussed earlier, whether it's your diet, your exercise, your lifestyle, that's one area. But sometimes if you have a particular, you know, genetic disorder or a medical condition, or if you're taking certain medications also, that could lead you to becoming obese. So that affects these adolescents even more if it is something like that that is causing their weight gain. And most of the time they get bullied, so they are not going to want to even come out of it. They will probably just say, well, I'm just going to remain being obese, because it's a very negative environment that everybody's pushing towards them. So you also, so that's why a support system is necessary, because you want to have some positive encouragement, motivation as well for them to even want to start to eat healthily. And it's also the household environment. So it could be the parents, it could be your friends, your siblings, that need to try to also encourage a person who is obese if they have somebody that they know, rather than giving them negative thoughts, to encourage them to do to work on you know, reducing their weight and trying to prevent the condition that they are in. So, and also, like, from some of the examples that I've seen, I can remember that we once I had a child that was obese, and the child was diagnosed with diabetes. So when I spoke to the child, and then I understood that the environment that they are in, so it may be that the foods that they are getting at home isn't really helping. So maybe the parents are also unaware of what healthy food choices are, and that, you know, by giving the wrong option, that they're only making the child's health condition worse. So that's where everybody needs to step in. So even if you have a sibling who's obese or a friend, I think it's also, I would encourage you to be nice, to motivate that person, and just, you know, be positive about it, rather than always saying, oh, you're this, you're that, because that doesn't help. So I think each one can, even if you are not obese as an individual, you can help someone and create an environment where it's easier for them to live in and try and tackle their problem. And that would really help. So that's where we all need to play a role in becoming part of that support system.
Right. Thank you so much. And I think it's also really important to remember that you can be body positive and still be working towards a healthier body. And you don't have to like go through shame. And I think that's a really important understanding that all of us have to come to terms with. So overall, the last question for today would be, what are the long-term advantages of preventing obesity, especially in when you're a child and in adolescence, so childhood and adolescence?
So like, I think we've gone through all the risks and what happens and all that. So I think it's simply the complete opposite. So you will have, if you prevent from becoming obese, you need to start young as well, because what you eat as a child will then, you know, it's going to go on as you become an adolescent and an adult, and then you go on to have your own family, especially for the girl child. So if you prevent obesity, you're definitely going to have a better quality of life. And then that means you will reduce your risk of getting non-communicable diseases. Again, means you can be more focused at your studies, your workplace, and you're obviously going to be an asset, not only to yourself, but to your family, to your community, and also in the end to your country, because you are going to be a productive person. Because if you're ill and you can't do things, then you're a person in the whole system that's taken out, and probably a liability because you're adding, you know, to the healthcare system. So if you are able to prevent and lead a healthy life, then yes, there's a win-win situation for everybody. We would like to think that everybody would thrive to be like this.
Yeah, okay, true that. I think thank you so much for touching on how important it is to develop good healthy practices as a child and as an adolescent, so that, you know, we have a better, healthier and much more happier life in the future, and especially as girl children, how important this is for us as well. So I think that brings us to the end of our interview today with Ms. Lasika Jayamaha. And once again, thank you so much, Lasika, for being with us here today and sharing your insights and your thoughts with us. And we really value that you took time off your busy schedule to be with us here today. So I personally learned a lot from this, and I really thank Lasika for being with us here today. And overall, that's the end. And I really hope to see all of you in our next session. So till then, signing off.